Welcome back, everyone, and a very good afternoon. Now we start with our next session, and the topic for the session is Digital Integrated Smart Cities. And we have a moderator for the session, Ms. Neetika Chhabra, Associate Director, KPMG. May I request her to please come on stage? So Ms. Neetika Chhabra, Associate Director, Infrastructure, Government and Healthcare is at KPMG with over 20 years of experience in enterprise, architecture, software lifecycle development, and digital transformation across telecom, IoT, and CRM verticals. May I now request to come on stage our keynote speaker, Mr. Vinay Thakur, please. He is the Director, National E-Governance Division, NEGD, Government of India. I also call upon Mr. Anil Thak, Head Digital Business, Schindler, India. Next, please come on stage, Mr. Gaurav Agarwal, Managing Director, Symentac, India and SAARC. Mr. Govind Singh Chauhan, Executive Director, Business Development, ABM, Knowledgeware, India. Mr. Govtham Kumar Sampath, Head ICT Research, Infoholic Research, India, please. I also call upon Mr. Ashdhir, Kinra, CEO, Cohesive Technologies, India. And Dr. Harsha, Thennarasu, CISO, HKIT, India. And last but not the least, Mr. Vasudevan, Venkatakrishnan, Business Development Director, APAC, Ruckus Air Networks, and CommScope. May I please request Ms. Neetika to please take the lead? Now over to her, please. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, a very warm welcome to everyone, the panelists, the esteemed guests, and the audience for being here and listening to what we have in terms of digitalization in smart cities. So I start the session with Mr. Vinay Thakur. Mr. Vinay Thakur is presently working as Director Projects, National E-Governance Division, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Shri Thakur has more than 20 years of experience in implementing IT and e-governance projects. So, sir, I welcome you and would request you for the keynote address. Yes, sir.
Very good afternoon. The dignitaries on dais, speakers, delegates, and ladies and gentlemen. In today's world, isolation probably has no meaning. We require the systems to be integrated, interoperable, and connected. And probably the theme of today's session, the integrated smart cities, is very apt for the occasion. When we started, I am from Ministry of Electronics and IT, and when we started Digital India program in 2014, one of the sub-vision areas was the integrated governance, integrated services. And we have, over last 4 or 5 years, we have tried to integrate many systems within the government, and we are trying to have the service-oriented systems where we are talking in terms of faceless, paperless, and cashless type of governance. So all the systems needs to be the part of that integrated paradigm. Smart cities project, which is very, very innovative and started by the government, are definitely to drive the economic growth and improve the quality of life in urban areas. In addition to urban areas, I just want to tell you that we have in Digital India, we have opened common service centers, and we have around 3 lakh common service centers in rural areas. So connecting rural and urban areas to this governance system has been the major theme of Digital India program. Digital India program has three vision areas where we were setting up digital infrastructure across country. We have digital services, and then last vision was the empowerment. And all these vision areas definitely have a very close connect and synergies with Smart City program, which was started by Government of India through Ministry of Urban Development. Under this convergence of Smart City and Digital India, you may be aware we have started a collaborative program called MyGov, where we take, where we interact, where the people can interact with the government through that program. And that program was widely used while the planning for Smart City was started in different places. Pune was the one where the feedback, the inputs from the people were taken through MyGov platform. So MyGov is one of the big platforms to ensure citizen engagement through the system under Digital India, and definitely which was used for Smart City. We are also working on smart healthcare, and that definitely will be forming the part of Smart City mission also. We have e-hospital system working right now in major hospitals. Around 300 odd hospitals, we have an e-hospital system. And in Delhi hospitals and many other hospitals, we have an online appointment system with doctors. So you can directly go to the online system, ors.gov.in, and take appointment with AIIMS or any other hospital out there in the country. Another program which is very, very much connected, which was started in the Digital India and connected with Smart City, SWAM for education, where we have built a massive online content, and it has a video lectures, it has some other material which can be downloaded, printed. We have even NCERT books are all available in digital form so that students can make use of these books. We have also started one program called eBasta, where Basta bag can be built by the teacher for the students. So whatsoever material is being taught by her or him by the teacher can be included in that Basta of that particular class. So these are few of the programs which we have started under Digital India program and has a lot of relevance out there for the Smart City. Another program which we started and hold great value is Umang, Unified Mobile App for Next Generation. Through a single mobile app, you can right now take around 389 government services are available through Umang app. And these services, whether they are of municipality or they are of some other government department or even from the private sector, which have been integrated in a small in one app called Umang. Another system which we have started is DigiLocker, which I was talking, we are moving towards paperless governance. So right now, CBSC, mark sheets, your Aadhaar card, everything almost is available in your DigiLocker. In case you have not opened DigiLocker account, kindly open it. And all these documents can be directly pulled from the original repository, which in some cases is CBSC, some cases Aadhaar, or even other issuer who are creating the details, the papers for you, are integrated as a part of DigiLocker system. Another program which is very, very relevant is GIS planning. We have started under Digital India one center called National Center of Geoinformatics, where we are providing GIS-based decision support system for the government. It includes, we are working with Niti Aayog, we are trying to plan the solid waste management for the country. We are also working with aspirational districts. We are working with mining department for mine lease. So around 240 applications earlier where we were working through tabular databases, now we are trying to integrate the GIS, the mapping part with tabular part so that we can provide the better decision support system and better planning for all the systems and decision making needed at grassroots level. We are also working on other collaborative system. We have one open forge where the programmers, the techies can collaborate and then work together, program together, and then build the solutions which can be even exported, build the solutions and products which can be exported to other countries. We have also come out with e-governance standards so that while the smart city systems, smart city softwares are integrated, they follow the standards, e-governance standards, which could be technical standards or domain-specific standards. Those are also available on our website. Another but very, very, very important system which right now we are working is Open API. As I have spoken in the beginning that isolated system will not work, and we have a lot of legacy systems which were done in isolation. Now we are trying to integrate these legacy systems through Open API, and these Open APIs will also be available not only to the government sector, to the industry also. That is another system which we are right now working. So there is a lot of synergy, there is a lot of integration which is there between Digital India program and Smart City program, and we are trying to provide all the support to the government, to the Ministry of Urban Development, to various smart city PMUs and smart city administration in this regard. So that is all from my side, and I wish all the best to this expo and to all the delegates. And this will go in a big way in further planning the smart cities in the country. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Vinay. We all have seen the success of MyGov especially, and the boost it has given to the confidence of citizens that their participation in all of these initiatives really makes a difference towards the growth of the country. We look forward to few more such initiatives by Digital India, Smart City initiatives, where we will have many more service-oriented systems and cashless and faceless systems. And now we have the industry presentation by Mr. Anil Tak. Mr. Anil is a mechanical engineer with master's degree in business management. He has about 12 years of experience in handling various assignments nationally and internationally. And he today is talking about leveraging the power of IoT by Schindler while they make elevators and escalators.
Okay. Are we good to go? Yeah. Thank you, Neetika. Thank you for the introduction. And thanks to Exhibitions India for giving this opportunity. My name is Anil. You know, we have been, since morning, we have been talking about smart cities, what all will be a part of smart city. We are still in a little bit confusion, not very clear. And maybe for another 3 days, we will hear a lot about that, what the smart cities are all about and what will be a part of smart city. So here today, for next 10 to 15 minutes, I'm going to take you through one of the key component of smart cities and how these things can become smart and ease our lives. So I introduce you to Schindler Ahead, which is a new solution from Schindler. And as I'm sure you all must be knowing, Schindler is one of the leading company into elevators and escalators globally. And this new solution is based on the increasing demand of Internet of Things, increased demand of smart elevators and smart escalators. And here, this is our introduction or our solution to our customers, to the market for making these smart cities actually smart. So going ahead, let me introduce you to IOEE, which is Internet of Elevators and Escalators. Now, what does that mean for us? What does that actually include? Imagine a situation where your equipments or your elevators in which everyone travels daily, maybe when you go to the office or when you are at your residence, they talk to you. They communicate to you that what is their health, what is happening with them. That is actually going to be smart, right? They will send an SMS or a text on your smartphones that, hello, hi, I'm running smooth, I'm having, everything is fine with me, or I'm having a problem. So isn't it that's going to be smart? Or when you arrive at the building, before you arrive there, you can actually call your elevator, you can call your escalator. So that is actually leveraging Internet of Things, leveraging Internet of Elevators and Escalators. What you see here on the screen, on the left-hand side, if you see, there's an elevator which is moving up and down in the building, which is always there. It never goes out, never communicates. But we have leveraged IoT. We have designed a smart box which gets connected to these elevators, and your elevator starts communicating. Your elevator starts talking to you and gives you insights and information of what is happening with it. Now imagine a community, a smart city, where these equipments are talking to the residents, talking to the people who are residing there. And also to all the stakeholders, right from the technician who is maintaining this elevator, the people who are traveling, or a central command center, where we can have a remote monitoring in place and somebody sitting miles and miles away can know what is happening with this equipment, can remotely diagnose, can remotely support a technician to make this ready for a use. Let me take you through a video which will give you much more details about the solution, what I'm talking about.
The Internet of Things. Connecting products to the digital world has arrived. What does this mean for passengers and for your business? From now on, you can intuitively interact with the elevator itself. Take a look at the panel which is opposite the doors. As you can see, it will sense what information you need and keep you current during our journey. But there is much more going on. As you will see, all the essential components are equipped with sensors, sensing the smallest vibrations, temperature fluctuation, energy consumption, and many more. The elevator's health condition is constantly measured and known at all times. As an example, above the door, there is critical equipment that opens and closes the door and ensures smooth operation. Connected sensors measure real-time data points like the door's motor temperature, voltage consumption, and open and close cycles. Anomalies in the data can now be detected instantly, and an alert is sent to the Schindler Control Center. All necessary data, such as location of the elevator, time of incident, and affected components are reported. Our powerful data analytics and machine learning algorithms support our experts to analyze the data and gain the right actionable insights. In this case, a predictive maintenance routine is suggested to prevent a potential failure in the future. Once confirmed by the expert, in addition to the client being informed about a newly scheduled maintenance visit, the necessary spare parts are ordered and our highly trained technician is automatically assigned. Our technicians receive the new job with maintenance instructions on their digital tool case. Thanks to our closed-loop platform, the customer is informed at all times about the health status of all of his equipment. The customer on-site personnel is informed, as well, at all times, via the Schindler app on their smartphone. As you can see, sensor data allows for powerful analytics and insights with the right outcomes for our customers, passengers, and employees. Schindler's Internet of Elevators and Escalators will significantly improve reliability and safety, while dramatically reducing equipment downtime and allow for a superior passenger experience. At Schindler, we power digital urban mobility for all types of elevators and escalators.
Well, you just saw the power of Internet of Things. You know, what we have done here is we have put IoT, artificial intelligence, and machine learning, all three together, and come up with this solution. And the whole objective of this solution is the benefits. What is the benefit for me, or what is the benefit for you out there? So what we see is the key benefit is the convenience. So if you see, today is in a smart world where we are so much dependent on our smartphones, you also want this information will be to be readily available, to be easily available to you. So we have designed a solution where you can have dashboards or the apps on your iPhones or on your Android phones, and you can have access to the information remotely. Like when you are sitting here, And what's happening with their equipments down there in your office building or in your residential building, you can get an immediate information on your smartphones. This is something in terms of a dashboard-wise. So what exactly information you get is the what is the uptime of an elevator, what is the current status, what are the elevators which are running, if there's a breakdown, or if there's a maintenance going on, all the information are easily available in your dashboard. And at the end, what are the benefits that we are looking at? So what we are trying to do is we are trying to solve the problem before it occurs. So that means we are trying to attack at the symptom level, attack at the error code level, so that there is minimum breakdowns. And at the end, we are trying to assure higher availability of these equipments, higher availability of elevators, which is the lifeline of any vertical building which is there. And when we are talking about smart cities, I'm sure we are talking about a vertically high-rise buildings, because of course we don't have so much of land availability in the urban developing cities. So we are assuring a higher uptime. And the second is the real-time information, real-time insights, and directly coming from the equipment, which is within the fraction of a second. And the third, again, the very important thing is how we can transform how people travel in these elevators. Now, if I ask a question to all of you, can these equipments, which are static in the building, which are just within that core and moving up and down, can generate revenue for you as a building owners or a facility managers? You can generate revenue by elevators or escalators while you are using them? A little confused, right? So that is our next proposition, which is ahead advertising. How we can generate revenue with these elevators and escalators. So we have come up with a digital solution, which is again an IoT-based solution, leveraging IoT to the fullest, and created a touch points where you can advertise on these products and generate revenue. Let's have a quick look at what exactly I'm talking about. You saw that we are all the more becoming digital with each passing day and no more want to be dependent on paper and want to go in a paperless environment, a green environment. So one of our proposition is a door show, which is live within this premises in our booth. But I want to show a video to you so that you can see that what actually I'm talking about. So this is ahead door show.
Schindler Door Show transforms elevator doors into advertising space. Make waiting entertaining. Information, news, and advertising delivered to your audience where once all they did was wait. This exclusive advertising space offers you completely new ways of communicating with your customers in top locations such as arenas, shopping centers, hotels, and airports. Our easy-to-use technology works with almost every elevator. The key component, a smart projector that projects whatever you want onto the elevator doors. Easily organize and schedule content using our software, all at the touch of a button. An investment that really pays. Make waiting more enjoyable with Schindler Door Show.
this is exactly how you can generate revenue from your elevators. And this is not the limit. This is just the beginning. And there are many more advertising solutions based on elevators and escalators, which is truly going to change the whole experience, how we used to travel in elevators and escalators in these smart cities tomorrow, a truly smart, a truly digital city. So I encourage all of you that we have a booth here, C170, where we have a live demo of Door Show as well. Please come and witness the technology live already implemented in our country. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anil. Thank you so much for giving such an insight into the depth of technology, which a lot of times we use. However, we do not realize the science behind it. So some very interesting anecdotes that we saw in the video. And now we'll go ahead with each of the panelists. So I think the major question that we have, and the context has been set by Anil, is in terms of how the smart cities and the digital integration has brought in the entire ecosystem of technology, and what is the impact on the social and the human factors thereof. How are we going to ensure the sustenance of these solutions in our everyday life? So I will start with Mr. Gaurav. Gaurav is the managing director at Symentac for its enterprise security business in India and SAARC. Based in Delhi, he leads all aspects of Symentec's business in India and SAARC, including sales, business, operations, and business development. Gaurav, over to you on what are your views.
We live in an interesting world, and how many of you use technology to live? Show of hands, right? WhatsApp gets seen every 2 minutes, email gets checked every 10 minutes. All our approvals that we do are on email. All the personal communication we do with our families today on WhatsApp. I've had the privilege and experience of working with a lot of government clients as well. In fact, a lot of critical projects progress was tracked on WhatsApp because they were critical and you could get people at 12 a.m. together and take actions immediately if something was going wrong. Now, Symentac, the world's largest cybersecurity firm, we protect consumers, businesses, governments to stay cyber secure. And when you look at smart cities, two aspects come to mind. One is the consumer. Second, the businesses that interact on the smart city platform. And third is the government or the smart city mission that is providing the platform for these interactions to happen, right? So I don't know how many of you heard of Dragonfly. Any show of hands of anybody heard Dragonfly? Now, Dragonfly, it's not a bug. It's something that took the energy grid down, or has the capacity to take the energy grid down in the most advanced nations in the world. And still nobody knows who's controlling this bug. And why did this bug or this problem get created? Somebody in an energy utility company opened an email, and that email opening put something on the IP address of the computer, which then took the essential IP addresses of the grid and transformed that to the attacker, where the attacker could attack. While coming to this event today, a friend of mine just called me and said, "Hey man, I am running a small business, and I just got this email. Some employee in my organization opened an email, and now, by the way, all my servers are encrypted, and I've got an email saying with a sample key and showing me how I can decrypt, but now they're asking me for serious money if I really want to decrypt everything, and what do I do?" And he had no clue on what to do, right? Pay ransom and get attacked again, and he doesn't have a backup of solutions. So as we get integrated into using technology, I think it's very important that we realize the importance of how to secure the access of this technology. How many of you have Wi-Fi routers at home? And what's the password of that Wi-Fi router when somebody from Airtel or Reliance or BSNL comes in, does maintenance? I can guarantee 75% of you will say admin 123, right? So the router that controls the access to your home, and you're going to connect more and more IoT devices to that router, which includes your TV, which includes your printer, perhaps the fridge tomorrow, the ACs tomorrow, can get controlled by a password that's known to everybody in the world. Now, what? Imagine a situation where that could cause overheating of devices and perhaps a fire at a home level. Imagine a city, for example, most smart city projects started getting conceived with surveillance, right? And surveillance is a lot of data. Imagine that data not being accessible for the person who's used that data because somebody put a ransomware to it. Communication from an IoT device perspective being hampered because of control. We did the study, Symentac has 9 trillion telemetry points across the world, and we run the world's largest civilian threat network. You put an IoT device on the network, it gets hacked in less than 2 minutes. Now, the problem is some of these IoT devices will not have capability to put passwords, change passwords, and you will do patch management in a manner which is not secure. So the reality of the world that we live in today is it is connected. We have to use these tools to survive, to work and operate, and there are ways to secure them. What we need to do as planners, thinkers, doers is, whenever we are thinking of connecting, opening up, first think, is the connection needed? Yes. If it is needed, how do I secure it? How do I protect the data do I have? For example, the mobile device that we all carry is the biggest spy device that was ever got created. You know, there's this application called as Torchlight, and this is just one example. Torchlight has been downloaded by more than 1 million users worldwide. When you download Torchlight and you say, I give it permissions to be used on my phone, you know, what are you signing up for? You're signing up for Torchlight to have the access of your location. You're signing up for Torchlight to open the camera when it wants to. You're signing up for Torchlight to open the microphone and record your conversations. And it opens, and you're giving Torchlight to access the storage on your phone, delete and modify the storage. Now, why would a flashlight application need these accesses? But the reality is that that flashlight application is selling this information to businesses to be viable. And that's why before you download an application, it's important to figure out what's the use, whether it's in smart city context or as a consumer, figure out how do you secure connectivity and make sure that you have security to warn you if things are doing what they're not supposed to do. So it's an interesting world, and we are there to help. So I'm not saying go back to Stone Age and not implement technology, but how to implement technology is extremely important, and keeping it secure is even more so because credibility of using that technology depends on security. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Gaurav. Thank you for touching the aspect of caution that technology brings, but I think we have enough eminent speakers here who would let us know how we can manage these breaches and take care of them. And now I move on to Mr. Govind Singh Chauhan. Govind Singh Chauhan is the executive director of ABM Knowledgeware, and he has about 30 years of overall experience, which includes 20 years with ABM. He has comprehensive knowledge of leading large e-government projects like Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai, Kalyan Dombivli, Madhya Pradesh Urban Administration, and Urban Development and Housing Department of Bihar. So over to you, sir, for your views.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Govind. I represent a company called ABM Knowledgeware. We take pride in saying that today we handle more than 1,000 municipalities spread across 5 states in our country. And out of the current 100 smart cities which have been declared, 26 of them already use our solutions. We are primarily focused on software and services for e-governance. I would be speaking fundamentally about e-governance and citizen services delivery. E-governance, citizen services delivery, citizen empowerment, these things have been going on almost for 2 decades now. They have been using, or they have been touching some aspects, some have been very comprehensive, some have been very piecemeal kind of efforts. The depth of some of the efforts have been very high, some have been very superficial, but there have been efforts in the last 2 decades. And all these efforts were probably best of the efforts when we see in the context of the kind of technology which was available at various points in time. But today, when we look around the kind of technology available, the kind of government thrust, as well as the citizen pull which is coming, there's a need for a complete paradigm shift of how we look at citizen services delivery, e-governance, governance in general. And as Mr. Thakur said, actually when I say that paradigm shift is required, probably on the central side, government has already taken those initiatives right since 2014 onwards. Probably the adoption of these initiatives in the field has to improve a lot. Some of my thoughts when I say that a paradigm shift is needed are the very concept that I, as a citizen, when I need a service, I need to apply for it. While applying, I need to give a lot of data. Then somebody on the government side will check whether I have given that data is correct or not. Then maybe apply some discretion and finally decide whether I'm going to get that service or not. I think this concept needs to be revisited because my eligibility for availing a particular service or otherwise is primarily dependent on data which is already there with the government, maybe with different departments. So if I'm eligible as per data available with governments at various departments, why do I need to apply for it and somebody needs to do a checking for the data which is already there with you? So this method of first I seek a service, I request a service, and then I'll get the service, this needs to be revisited. The second thought I have is that when you go through the procurement processes of various smart cities, there is this discussion that there is an e-gov track, e-governance track, and there is an ERP track. Very broadly speaking, e-governance, say people mean the things which are citizen facing, and ERP means things which are back office facing. I think there is a fundamental disconnect here. The citizen is expecting some services. The government officers, staff are there to give those services. It has to be a common system where one set of users is citizens and another set of users is the back office or the internal users from the government side. There cannot be two different systems, one the e-governance system, the other is ERP system. The third thought I have is that for everything, for every improvement, you don't need technology. Very simple administrative reforms or your business process reforms can yield great results. Somehow, city after city in the whole procurement process, we are missing this point. If I give a very small example, I'll take 1 minute for that. All these urban bodies, the municipalities as we know them, they give various kind of licenses, they collect property tax, they give various permissions. If you look at anybody's data, and I think with fair degree of certainty I can say that this would apply to almost all the municipalities, 90% of the cases, nothing changes. If I am a shop owner, I am running, let's say, a clothes shop, I am running that shop for the last 20 years. Nothing actually changes, but every year I go for my license renewal. And when I say 90%, I am trying to be modest. Actually, it might be as high as 95% also. What changes is only the 5% part. But all this 100% mass needs to go through that process every year. Year on year. If I do this auto renewal, if I enable that auto renewal, and there's no technology involved here, it's just a simple administrative reform that needs to be implemented, those 90-95% footfalls in your municipality, or even if you are going digital, those visitors on your app or on your website, they will actually stop. You would be renewing it yourself and just sending a message to the applicant or the beneficiary or that licensee that your application is renewed. If the person wants to stop his business, he'll come back to you. Now, these kind of simple things can actually, get you much better dividends than what we are targeting. One more thing, that the very concept of smart cities, at least as we understood, is not about municipal computerization. When I, as a citizen, expect something from government, I actually do not know whether this service is given by a municipality or a PWD or a police department or a water authority. I just need a service. Probably, under the garb of smart cities, what is happening is the computerization or enhancement of existing computerization of municipalities alone, which I think needs a relook again. here the idea of smart cities was that everyone who contributes to making the city smarter, be it roads department, which may not be within the purview of municipality, or may it be policing, or may it be some PWD kind of department, everybody should come together and make the city smarter. When it comes to application space, we realize that this concept is probably being misinterpreted or not being adopted in completeness. And last but not the least, if we look at the technology component, today the time has come where the fundamental interaction point has to be the mobile device and not the desktop or a laptop. Or we need to actually use tools available in artificial intelligence, machine learning, whereby we do away or minimize the efforts required for data entry and stuff like that. So those are the points that we need to, incorporate and then, design our citizen services projects, citizen delivery projects and governance projects.
Thank you so much. I think these smart cities have actually given a very nice platform for the e-governance initiatives to begin, and I think it's a good beginning. And we do see a lot of solutions, a lot of services, I should say, government services coming up and getting integrated. Yes, we have a long way to go, and we look forward to more solutions, innovative ones from the industry to make such a thing happen. So going ahead, I request Mr. Gautam Kumar Sampath for his views. He is the head of ICT research of Infoholic Research LLP. With more than an experience of a decade of experience, he comes with an extensive consulting and market analysis skills in IT services, electronics and communication industries, with specific focus on infrastructure services and business intelligence and analytics. So, Gautam.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Because I represent a market research company, when we think about smart city, it's more to do with data. So we typically think of smart city as something which aggregates data, and then it associates data, analyzes it, and then creates an anticipation. This is the model that we think of. And when Mr. Chauhan said about individual authorities might not have the necessary power or the necessary areas that they can provide services with, it will eventually move towards a decentralized model. The command and control center alone or the governance authority cannot remain in one single place. It will definitely move towards a decentralized mode. And then we would probably see that it will remain as the data aggregator, but then individual services will remain closer to the necessary services that need to be provided. With smart cities, again, when in Bangalore, they started putting up smart meters in our houses. And immediately we started thinking that, why is somebody monitoring us? We are already paying water tax for this, and what is the whole idea of this? While the initial format is to think that the monitoring has to happen in terms of what is the usage, what is happening, we need to think long-term as well. While it initially looks like data-centric, it also has a human-centric approach or a human-centric vision towards it. There is quite a lot of water leakage happening, and we as consumers don't know about it. And without analyzing this data, how can we fix what the problem is? Because according to UN's report, Bangalore is probably going to see day zero in a couple of years or in the next 5 years. And that is not great for us. And I think this vision is already set with some of the authorities that came up with some of these projects, where it is essentially data-oriented or data-centric, but then it also has that human-centric focus in it. It's just that it is going to take some more time for us to see the value. And every time we discuss smart cities with somebody, trying to answer certain questions on what would be the market size or how to compare certain things with global perspectives, the question always comes, why is a Singapore like this? Why is a Dubai like this? Because they have spent years, decades of investment on that, and we have just started doing it now. And that too, the basic infrastructure has to be built first. And only then can we start building the digital parts of it, and then probably move to next-gen technologies, which would deliver services. It's not going to happen right away. There could probably be a second phase of smart city that would come in probably the next 5 years. And that is what will actually reap us the benefits that we as citizens think how it should be.
Thank you, Gautam. I think you touched a very profound point that it's not just the solutions. There are various layers to the entire smart city solution which needs to be worked out, and one of them being the foundational one, which is the communication. And with that, I come to Ashdhir Kinra.
Sorry to disturb you, ma'am. Now we have a release of a research paper by Infoholic Research. May I request our moderator and Mr. Sampath, along with our other speakers, to release the research paper, please.
So Mr. Ashdhir Kinra, he is the CEO of Cohesive Technologies. And before starting Cohesive Technologies, he worked 14 years in the telecom industry, mainly dominated by TDM technology. He was clear from the day one that VoIP is the technology of future. And I'm sure he has much to add in terms of what smart cities can utilize out of that.
Good afternoon. Namaskar sabko. So, guys, to make before I start, I'll just divide smart city into three components. Okay, the first component is the hardwares which we see on the roads. There are cameras, emergency call boxes. There is an access system. You have a car battery charging. The second is an IoT, which Anil spoke about. So there are a lot of companies which are developing products on IoT, which can be, which Anil just spoke about, advertisements on elevators, some AI-based tools where the machine's faults are being addressed and the text messages are coming on the mobiles. And the third is what Vinay spoke about, is about some government applications with an open API interface where citizen, because this all technology, which either it's a hardware or a application or an IoT, has to be a citizen-centric. You know, the biggest irony today in Smart City India 2019 is that it's not an integrated solutions. All these three components, A, B, and C, either it is cameras on the roads, either it is an emergency call box, an SOS buttons, the Wi-Fi areas, the IoT devices, as said by Anil, which can be switching on an air condition in the room or putting an advertisement on the elevators, or going for my kid's birth certificate on the kiosk or on my browser, but nothing talks to each other. No one talks to each other. So the integration and the convergence is the word which is missing in smart city. How easy it would have been that if a citizen, a guy like you, is on the road with your father and your father has an emergency, he can press the button and the call will go not only to the healthcare, but a video feed from the camera can go to the command center. But today, your all products work standalone. So the integrated smart city where people are working, there's a new technology which is coming up in the world. It's called long range radios. In short form, it is called LoRa. Now the LoRa technology which is coming globally, the radios can work up to 15 kilometers, and this LoRa chipsets would be there in each and every device, including your SIP servers and PBX. So just think about a situation what Anil spoke, that not only a text message, but if his elevator fails, the call can go to the command center. the phone call can go to the command center, not onto the only onto the through a GSM, but onto the command center. Someone is doing a birth certificate on the website, and I have some problem in filling in the form. I can press the tab button straight on the website, and I can do a video call with the command center. Similarly, if there is a riots in the city, something like what we observe in the case of a civil wars, which happens in cities, the video feeds can lively go integrated to the command center where people are not only just viewing the surveillance, but they can have a phone calls giving a video feed on what's happening. There's a crime happening in area A, and the crime notification goes not only to the police, but the police can announce it into the city on zone voice from the command center. So your public address systems of cities, your surveillance of cities, your IoTs of cities, your cyber browsers, applications, all connected on one platform where the carrier can be a 5G, which I think some people will take care in the next session, or a long range radio connected on a SIP server is the solution. Because till the things, these things are not integrated, the smart city would not be an integrated. So my only thought process which I am leaving here that it has to be an integrated solutions. And we have a booth here where we guys are talking about the integrated solutions, and we are making every product talk to each other, which is C144 in booth in exhibition hall number 11. So we invite everyone to come and see the future of the smart city. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashdhir. I am very sure with the larger proliferation of the M2M coming into play, we will see the light of LoRa, Sigfox, and other protocols coming in where you use much lesser power and are able to communicate the packets required for this kind of communication. So now I come to another aspect of smart cities. We are building smart cities and having a lot of IoT solutions in place. But what in terms of the security and privacy of the data that we are collecting? So I come to Dr. Harsha Thennarasu, who is the CISO, HKIT Security. He is a noted expert on information security with a passion for and keen understanding of the subject. He is a pan-India trainer for Reserve Bank of India, dealing with subjects of information security, cyber crimes, and physical security. So Dr. Harsha, over to you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, guys. All of you are physically present, mentally absent, or both? Okay, good. I'm Dr. Harsha. I represent HKIT Security Solutions. We are into cyber security assessments. We handled almost 500 plus projects like airports, metros, and oil and gas manufacturing like that. So here, when I look into the smart cities, my personal view, make sure that everything's on same page. Do you know what is the meaning of that? Can anybody tell? Everything should be on same page. What does that mean? Device should be on same page. Resource should be on same page. Technology should be on same page. If there is one gap, and then smart city will become dash, dash, dash. I could come across with one of the airport recently when I was visited. It's also one of the smart city. I could find there is one misconfiguration on their Wi-Fi network. Being hackers, it's easy to get into the network and find the loophole and breach. And smart cities, according to me, it's a mindset. The technology comes next. That's the reason I was telling you, everybody should be on same page. I can give one example. I could visit one of the stall where I could see the older protocol was there in the configuration, specification of the product. I don't want to name anybody, but I was asking them, in case, if you allow the older protocol, that means outdated protocol within your product, maybe people may use that. They may not aware of what is the latest one, which needs to be configured. So according to me, the configuration, misconfiguration makes major part, and from vendor, resource, technology should be on same, and we need to have a very strong framework to address all of them. And we need proactive approach in terms of identifying a cyber threats. What is that advanced proactive approach? The managed detection and response. I think most of you are aware of SIEM products. So when we are building a smart city, we need to focus on all security controls, and the proactive approach should be there to make sure that the smart cities are successful. Thank you so much for giving opportunity.
Yes, I think that's really an important aspect, that it's not just the technology, but till you have the cogs of people and process being in place, just putting in too many locks is not going to change the way the things work. So thank you so much. And now I come to Mr. Vasudevan Venkatakrishnan. With over 16 years experience in telecom industry, Vasudevan is the business development director for Ruckus Wireless, focusing on strategic partners, service providers, and special projects. Currently, he also leads the Smart City IoT cloud initiatives for Ruckus across APAC. And prior to joining Ruckus, Vasudevan led all technical engagement activities for mobile core networking products in Cisco in ASEAN. Over to you, Vasudevan.
Thank you. Afternoon. So, Smart Cities is all about, you know, connected cities, and I think network connectivity is the underlying factor of whatever you call a smart city, which is effectively a connected city, and that's what Ruckus Networks, the company, focuses on today, is to provide connectivity in all forms, be it wired, wireless, it could be for an enterprise, it could be for an airport, for a building. You know, Mr. Anil talked about intelligent lifts, again, smart buildings. You're talking about connectivity there for enterprises. All aspects of connectivity, and underlying factor is the network infrastructure that you actually build can actually support the smart city initiatives that is actually driving enough amount of data for you. So starting from building fiber on the ground to Ethernet to in-building DAS, 4G, Wi-Fi, switching, you want to make sure that the network connectivity that you actually build out can actually address the capacity needs. And to begin the whole session, where Mr. Gaurav said, you're sending WhatsApp. Most of the people are connected on WhatsApp. The whole idea about smart cities is all about improving efficiency and communication, and efficiency from a government perspective or agencies, how they actually work, and improving lives of people where they're actually able to connect to systems and provide solutions for the betterment of their living. So I think that's what we look to do, and looking forward for some interesting conversations today. Thank you.
So thank you. I think a very important aspect that it's not just the smart cities. The society becomes smart when you have smart societies, you have smart buildings, you have smart homes. And the need of technology in there is going to be different for each one of them. So we need a varied amount of solutions and innovations to make the entire ecosystem smart. So we've heard everyone in terms of the solutions that they bring forth. Now I open up a question for the panel. In terms of smart cities, what do you think are the must-haves that are already implemented, and what do you think are the trends that need to be taken up so that as a society we actually turn out to be smart?
I can take it up. So again, I think the first aspect is every city, every location has its own definition of what a smart city is. It could be as simple as security aspects. It could be as simple as improving lives. So we have seen a lot of initiatives for the last 4-5 years in India where security has been the key driving factor for driving smart city projects. So everything from surveillance cameras to, you know, command central center building up to ensuring that different agencies are able to leverage that. Connectivity has been the second one, Wi-Fi connectivity, where you could actually let citizens be able to come onto the network, come onto the internet, access information. Different cities, again, would have their own objectives. I think the first speaker talked about e-government applications and services. It could be simple as e-waste management itself or waste management. It could be portals or e-government services where you want to look at. So again, the definition is quite broad. As long as you're able to improve the lives, it could start off from a small building or a campus and expand to a city where different systems come in place, different agencies are able to leverage the technology to provide a seamless service to improve citizens' life. I think that's where the key is.
So what I hear is more than the technology, it is the custom centricity which actually matters.
Yeah, you need to define it. You have to have a clear definition of what you want to achieve. And technology then follows behind and which technology can actually help, right? So you need to define a problem and find a solution to address that problem. I think that's where the key is. It could be as simple as, e-rickshaw stands. I remember seeing the whole 100 smart city initiatives, simple things as waste management, e-rickshaw stands, which has nothing got to do with anything we're talking about here from a smart city, but it's basic services that people are able to actually improve their lives is what it is. And again, eventually, you know, you build networks and technology to support those services.
Right. So you've been part of a lot of, surveys and look around the country, how people are taking up smart city solutions. So what has it just been the technology which has been the driver, or how have you worked towards ensuring people utilize the e-governance services and various aspects of smartness?
Technology definitely is available everywhere. I think we need to rework out the requirements. We need to work on the integrated solution. I'll tell you one small example. We have been to Estonia, a small country having 11 lakh or 13 lakh population. So there is a single system, and you go down to that system, you can get your land records, you can get your school details, you can get your even police details. So there is a need where we need to build integrated system so that people need not to struggle here and there going from one portal to another portal. Rather, we should have a single portal serving the society in a better manner. That is number one. And second thing which we are struggling is the language, localization, which is very, very important, though may not be in urban context, but definitely we need to build the solutions in local languages. We need to solution which should be disabled friendly. So that is where probably industry also has to chip in and then provide support and solutions to the government.
So essentially convergence is what I hear in terms of solutions being integrated together. And that was one point that you had mentioned. Yes, please.
One thing I wanted to add that somewhere in this whole scheme of things, we need to provide a channel, you may call it a platform, you call it solution, whatever, where citizen is able to say what he wants. We are deciding what we want to automate, what we want to computerize, where we want to do integration. But where are the citizen preferences? As Thakur sir said that, I have seen one state having maybe some 20 odd citizen mobile apps. If I am in city X, then I have to download app 1. If I am in city Y, then I have to download app 2. Which citizen would prefer doing all this?
I come from Mumbai. Their online property tax payment is available since 2009. And I must tell you that the usage of online facility is less than 1%. And I am saying 1% because saying 0.1 something, etc., sounds very funny, you know. So I am saying less than 1%. And reason there is, it is financial capital of the country. Internet penetration is not a problem. IT savviness is not a problem. But the fact is that in Mumbai, bills of property tax are given society-wise, and a typical society bill would run into some 10 lakh, 15 lakh kind of thing. And no poor secretary of the society will ever try doing the online payment of that kind of amount. Now, so we need to identify which are the places where we need to put efforts, and probably the best person to know this is citizen. So we need to have a channel where citizen can give their requirements, their needs. They can get what data government already has, different departments of government. And I think that will be a good help in conceptualizing newer projects, in strengthening the existing projects.
And I think another, I would not say fear, but the reason what inhibits a lot of solutions from being taken up, one is the newness of the solution. And the second is, of course, the security and the privacy aspect, where people are scared about what information about them is available publicly.
Yes. So what we should be, what we should do is, we should be smarter than bad guys. We should be smarter than hackers. We should be smarter than attackers. Then only we can be more successful on that project. So let's take one example. 2-3 days back, there was a zero-day attack on WhatsApp. How many of us aware of that? Nobody knows. Okay. So if it is not patched, we are all under the threat. So how quickly we adopt the technology? That is very important point. By the time you you complete your procurement process and everything, the new version comes. Right? The technology is like now weekly magazine. Okay? Next week you don't need a last week magazine. Right? You would have already read or it is out of. So my suggestion is to adopt quick technology and bring the awareness. Irrespective of their public or technical people or leadership, they should be aware of the cyber threats and the technology innovations.
Great. So yes, anything new and technology comes with its own pros and cons. We have to use it smartly, and that is what this entire panel is about. So thank you everyone for sharing your views. A wonderful insight into the trends that we have coming up for the smart cities and things that we have to be wary of to ensure that whatever we are bringing makes a difference to the citizens, is citizen-centric, and makes us into a better society. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you so much. Before we close the session, I would request our moderator, Ms. Neetika Chhabra, Associate Director, KPMG, to give away mementos to our esteemed speakers. We start with Mr. Vinay Thakur. Mr. Anil Tak. Mr. Govind Singh Chauhan. Mr. Gowtham Kumar Sampath. Mr. Ashdhir Kinra. Dr. Harsha Thennarasu. And last but not the least, Mr. Vasudevan. May I request the lady from Exhibitions India? How come I missed her? Mr. Gaurav Agarwal, I'm so sorry. May I request from Exhibitions India a memento for our moderator? Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for conducting this session and finishing it on time.